The second core service, of course, is CPU scheduling. An exokernel, in order to facilitate this core service, maintains a linear vector of time slots. So time is divided into these epochs, T1, T2, T3, and so on. And every time quantum has a begin and end. And these time quantums represent the time that is allocated to the library operating systems that live on top of exokernel. And the time quantum is bound by the begin and markers for each library operating system. Each library operating system gets to mark its time quantum at startup in this linear vector of time slots. So for instance, OS1 may say that I get this time slot, I get this time slot, maybe some of the time slot, and so on. And similarly, OS2 marks its spots in this linear vector of time slots. So CPU scheduling in exokernel is essentially looking at this linear vector of time slots and asking the question, in this time quantum, which is the library operating system that should be running on the processor? And there is a start time for the time quantum, then the end time for the time quantum. And let's say OS1 is now running on the CPU. When the timer interrupt goes off at this endpoint, control is transferred by exokernel to the library operating system to do any saving that it has to do of the context. And the time that is allowed for a library operating system to do the saving and restoring of context at the point of a context switch is bounded. And if an operating system misbehaves, let's say that OS1, when exokernel says it's time for you to save your context and give back the processor to me so that I can schedule it for some other operating system, and let's say OS1 takes more time than it is allowed to at the point of this context switch, in that case, what will happen is exokernel will remember that OS1 misbehaved, and it will take time off of OS1 the next time it is scheduled. So there's a penalty associated with exceeding the time quantum. The time quantum is bound. During this time quantum, OS1 has complete control of the processor, and exokernel is not going to get in the middle of it unless a process that is running on behalf of OS1 incurs a page fault. In that case, exokernel has to come in the middle in order to field that page fault and pass it up to the operating system. And otherwise, during this time quantum, the operating system is entirely at liberty to use the processor for running whatever processes it wants to. At the end of the time quantum, the timer interrupt goes off, exokernel fields it, and kicks it up to the operating system and tells the operating system to clean up its act, save any context it wants, so that the CPU can be reallocated to the next library operating system. And that's where the time is bounded as to how much time the library operating system can take in order to do that saving of the context.